Hey, welcome once again to Leto's Law. I'm Steve Leto. Once again, I've got a guest in studio. And by the way, I've been meaning for a long time to have guests in studio, but there's several problems with it. Number one, no one ever actually wants to come out to my studio because I live out in the middle of nowhere. And number two, I never thought I had room in the studio. And then I realized I've got two chairs. How hard can it be? Drop in another chair and slide over a little bit. So, nice. Adam Alexander.
Hello.
Good to have you back.
Thank you.
We talked not too long ago about debts and things of that nature. You're an attorney like I am. I've been practicing law for 28 years. You've been practicing law for?
24 years.
24 years. We've known each other the entire time, even though those numbers don't quite jive for some weird reason. But you do a lot of stuff besides the Lemon Law. I do Lemon Law, so do you. But you also do stuff involving federal statutes, federal courts, and debts. And when we were talking most recently, you mentioned identity theft, which is something people talk about. First of all, what is it?
When someone steals your identity, most people would think identity theft is when there's a big breach, like the Target breach or the Wells Fargo bank breach, where millions of people's identities and personal information got stolen, and now somebody's got your information. That's identity theft. So they have your identity, they have your personal information, they can potentially open up credit accounts, go to the gas station and get gas, do a lot of things on your dime.
I know years ago I had a radio show and I had a guest on, and I'm talking about 1994, 95, in the early days of this idea. And a woman who was an attorney in California had a secretary who had access to all of her stuff and actually went out and bought a car, did all kinds of stuff, but in the attorney's name. And when the bills came to the office, she intercepted them, and she actually managed to do a whole bunch of stuff in the other. And I remember I had her on my show as a guest, and I'm like, this is crazy. And it never dawned on me about the fact it's going to mushroom as a problem over the years because largely I'm guessing the internet and things like that.
Yeah, well, that's interesting because I have a case right now that I'm handling with a doctor who did, he has staff who did just that.
Okay.
She opened up a credit card, started charging things. She had access to his bank accounts. He trusted her. So she literally started paying some of the credit card bills and had this thing going forever. And finally got caught, charged $40,000, and she got charged criminally. But the bank is pursuing my client, right?
Oh, God.
Saying that he was responsible, he should have been managing her, and he's responsible for the debt. So that's a different kind of identity theft. That's more like, fraud.
Right, but so you could have identity theft where somebody knows you and gets your information.
Right.
Somebody could go onto the dark web, wherever that might be, and buy your stuff.
What is that?
I don't know. It's out there somewhere.
Wait, what is this?
I'm not sure. We'll get to that later. Okay. The dark web could be selling your information, right?
Right.
Whatever that is. And so the idea that someone could nefariously steal your identity and like say take out loans in your name or things of that nature. But does it also sometimes occur accidentally?
Yeah. Mistaken identity.
Okay.
A lot of my cases involve very common names. I mean, if your last name is Smith and your first name is Robert, guess what? There's a million other of you.
Wait. So, that doesn't make you the lead singer of The Cure?
That's right, Robert Smith.
Just checking.
Yeah, there's no nobody that looks like that, so I don't think that's
okay,
happening.
Okay.
But a creditor might go after you if you have a very common name. There's also something called mixed files where a social security number is just one or two digits off, and they identify somebody, mistakenly identify somebody and go after that person.
Okay.
So there's a lot of ways where, there's this very small differences between somebody with names, social security numbers. So there's that mistaken identity. And I handle a lot of cases like that too.
Okay. So someone calls your office and a lot of the phone calls probably start with, you're not going to believe what happened to me. But you've actually heard it all before. Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to say, I believe it.
Okay, so you've seen the one where somebody stole the identity because they just got the information somehow.
Right.
You've had the ones where somebody got the information because of familiarity with somebody.
Right.
I have access to your mail. I've got access to your wallet. I've got access to your information.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that that's probably one of the reasons that they passed federal laws not too long ago about protecting medical records.
Right.
Because it used to be if you went to the doctor, they'd give you, ask if your name, your date of birth,
right,
mother's maiden name, your social security number.
Right.
Okay. And so you're giving all that to somebody who's going to, go, oh, yeah, take two of these and go home.
Right.
Yeah. So.
HIPAA.
Yeah, exactly. So what kind of remedies are there? If somebody, first of all, how do you, someone's stolen your identity. How do you make them stop?
Well, number one, go to the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission website, and fill out an identity theft affidavit. That's the first thing you need to do, okay? The second thing you need to do is make a police report. Those two things are very important, especially if your credit report gets derogated. You want to send that information, the police report and the identity theft affidavit, to them to try to straighten that out. And that's a whole different situation with your credit reporting. Let's just talk about identity theft. The most common case I get is like I said, where John Smith or John Brown, or a father son, where a father is the same name, jacks up credit cards and they come after the son, right?
Right.
That's, you know, very common. To stop those kind of cases, really, you have to take legal action. And, you know, number one, like I said, the police report and the affidavit, but also contact a lawyer. If creditors are coming after you for debt that you don't owe, seek representation. When it comes to the breaches, though, right, the big breaches where millions of accounts get stolen, I mean, you're almost out of luck. Yeah, those people are in the dark web.
Yeah. Well, you know,
you can't find those people.
This is where the safety in a herd. You just hope somebody else gets hit, but
right,
not you.
Right.
But I got to back up. Normally, I use big words all the time on this show, and I don't stop to define them because my audience is very smart.
Okay.
You actually used a word I've never used out loud before, and it's derogated.
Okay.
I assume it's the same root as derogatory.
Derogatory, damaged credit. So
somebody caused something bad to hit your credit report.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And,
okay.
And that's what happens in identity theft cases. It's not only, you know, your credit gets jacked up.
Right.
Well, now you look at your credit report and there's like five new accounts on there, and you made late payments, and you know your credit score.
How can it be late? I didn't even know this account existed.
Right. Exactly.
There you go. So you mentioned filling out an affidavit with the Federal Trade Commission, and generally speaking, most government agencies, as you know, are useless. Is there actually something you'll get from filling out the affidavit? Will it help you somehow?
Yes. I mean, you need it.
You have to.
So it's your testimony under oath that this is not your debt, that your identity was stolen. Okay.
Who do you file it with, though? Where does it go?
All the creditors. Anybody who's trying to collect money from you, right, that you don't owe. But also Experian, Equifax, TransUnion, anybody who, you know, if there's a credit report error, you need to send them your testimony, basically, that affidavit that, hey, this isn't me. Under oath, I'm saying I don't owe this debt.
Okay.
And it gives you, there's an area on the form that lets you explain what happened, how you don't live in the state where, you know,
stuff got
jacked up, all of that stuff. And also the police report is very important, too.
Okay, so the report, the affidavit from the FTC doesn't get filed with the FTC. It's just they've provided this form, and you fill it out, and then you start sending it out to the people you just mentioned.
Good point. You fill it out and print it out.
Okay.
I do believe you can file it with them and the CFPB, too. But
and at that point, you're basically putting people on notice, saying, I at least made this point on this date.
I reported it.
Okay. Yeah. Then the next question I have is, and again, I know that my audience is very intelligent, but they're also skeptical because they've learned from me, okay? How often do the police care if you call and say, I'd like to report an identity theft? Do they actually care?
Most of the time, no. Sometimes you'll get pushback from police departments, like, that's a civil issue, we don't want to get involved, but you know, I want you to be diligent if this happens to you, to get that report, get it signed by an officer, all right? It's very important to get it, make it official.
But I'm saying, like, let's suppose that you're in Detroit, the city of Detroit, and your identity gets stolen. Do you go to the Detroit Police Department and ask them? Because I have a feeling they get more important things to do. At least that's what they're going to tell you.
Right. No, it's difficult in big cities like that where, you know, something like that is just not really relevant.
Okay.
But again, you need to push for it. You need to go get that police report. It's very important in the process. So yes, you gotta, you know, do whatever you can. Show up at the door. Ask for the, you know, sergeant. Whatever.
Okay. So if you let's suppose you live in a nice small town, friendly police department. Andy comes out, takes your report, gives you the report. You've done the affidavit with the FTC. How hard is it to clean this mess up?
I mean, it varies dramatically. It could be easy. You might send this to the creditors, and some creditors are gonna go, got it. We understand. You have the affidavit. There's a police report. We're going to stop collecting this from you. We're going to note this on your account that you don't owe it. All right.
Okay.
Sometimes not. Sometimes they're going to keep on. We don't believe you. And I see that all the time.
Okay.
I didn't go to Sunoco in Georgia when I live in Michigan.
Right.
Like I don't understand that, but it's tough.
Yeah. No, it's kind of funny. Not too long ago, I traveled to New York, for a thing where I was a disc jockey at WLLW, and Geneva, New York.
What's the tagline for them?
Shut up and rock.
Shut up and rock.
And I was a disc jockey for a day, but I drove through Canada and I used my credit card in Canada and in New York.
Okay.
They called me and they actually said, we're just double checking and make sure that's you. And what's funny is the woman apologized. She goes, I'm sorry. No, I'm glad. This is the one junk phone call. This is not a junk phone call, but I'm saying phone call from somebody like that. I'm glad to get that because you can imagine if it was the other way around where I'm like, no, I'm not in Zimbabwe right now, you know, whatever.
Well, that's a good point. That's happened to me too. If you have accounts with some of the bigger banks, they're really trying to get on top of the security. Right. You'll get a text. You'll get a phone call. Sometimes they'll say they won't honor your purchase and they'll say, we don't know this is you.
Right.
Call us to, you know, which is frustrating if you're somewhere, you're in Mexico or something like that.
Embarrassing.
But it's, you know, security is important.
Right. So if somebody's stolen your identity and you do everything you just described right there and you're straightening this mess out, is there anybody you can go after? I mean, you know, the joke is if you have a hammer in your hand, the entire world looks like a nail. We're attorneys. We sue people.
Yeah, right.
Is there anything you can do as an attorney to help people straighten this out other than just give them advice?
For the larger breaches where millions of people are affected, you're never going to find those people who did the bad thing. But if there are banks that are still trying to get the money after you've provided them with, you know, proof,
right,
you can actually go after those banks. If there's, you know, credit bureaus like Experian, Equifax who refuse to take derogatory information off of your report, and if you've provided them with, you know, good information that it's identity theft or mistaken identity, then yes, I can help you. We can go after them.
Right.
All right.
Have you ever heard of somebody who was an identity thief who actually got in trouble, got arrested, anything like that?
You know, the story I just told you about the doctor,
his
staff stole his identity. She was prosecuted for a felony in that case.
Wow.
But it's rare.
Okay.
A lot of these people you can't find.
Right.
But in cases like, you know, where there's a person stealing identity rather than some kid in a computer hacking into a system, usually it's a family member, friend, coworker. You know, somebody that's trying to scam you out of money and take advantage of you. So those people can be found. Often they don't have money.
Or who wants to prosecute their...
Her best friend. Or their
failure to launch kid.
Sure. Yeah, right.
It happens.
Yeah.
It happens.
Yeah.
So is there, besides the obvious steps, is there anything we can do to prevent identity theft of ours? In other words, I know that they're going to say, you know, don't give your social security number out as an identifier if you can avoid it. What else could we do to avoid identity theft?
You know, The answer to that is there's not a lot you can do. I mean, you and I have been thefted dozens of times. Our identity, it happens every day. It happens to millions of people, and there's not a lot you can do about it.
So in one 20-minute period, you said derogated and thefted. just pointing that out.
Can we look that up? Is that a word or not?
If it's not, it is now.
Okay.
There you go.
So yeah, unfortunately, I mean, there's to you know, you can go on the FTC site and they give you some advice.
Right.
But listen, you know, in today's day and age, there's just not a lot you can do to prevent your identity from being stolen. Everything that you have is electronic. It's in the cloud. It's electronic. It's not like the old days when you had a credit card and somebody would have to literally like take your card
right.
and get the number. It's just like not like that anymore.
I worked at a gas station at 13 and Woodward back in the day when I was the cashier, but it was self-serve. But they didn't take card readers out at the pump. And so they had to come up and give you their card if they wanted a full tank of gas. And you'd hold the card and they'd come back and you clunk it through the thing.
Right.
One of my coworkers, I didn't know her very well, thankfully, when somebody would come up with a card, she'd run it through two or three times while they were pumping the gas. Then when the person signed the first receipt, she'd forge a couple more receipts.
Right.
And then she'd take the other receipts, put them in the cash drawer and take cash out. And what happened was some guy was checking his credit card receipt and it goes, you've made three purchases of $25 on the same day at the same Boron station at Woodward 13 Mile.
Right.
The guy called the police and goes, Boron. No, I didn't. So the police.
And she's hoping that you don't check your bill.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Right. And so what's funny is I actually came in and saw them hauling her out in handcuffs.
Yeah.
You know, right? I mean, those are the good old days.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just, you know, my example of it's hard to prevent. Think about that driver who came into the gas station.
Right.
There's no way that person could have prevented that from happening. She just did it.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's what happens today. People, but now it's on, you know, it's in the dark cloud.
Yeah, well, and
The dark web.
Which is on the cloud, I'm sure. the dark cloud. Another problem is, of course, I'm sure the updated version people know about this is card skimmers. they can actually put a little tiny device on this thing, so you don't even know it's there. You swipe your card, you buy the gas, and somebody else just got your information off that skimmer.
Right.
A friend of mine was driving on Turnpike in Florida, went someplace, got where they're going, and like an hour later started getting warnings coming up going, we think there's a problem with your card. And she'd used the card earlier that afternoon, and somebody actually cloned the card, went into the Boca Town Center, and ran up thousands of dollars of purchases before it got shut off.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, so it's the you can't keep ahead of the technology.
You can't. And now everyone's on social media and your identity. Everyone knows everything about you. So it's tough to prevent. Used to be just, you know, the good advice was, and it still is, you know, don't give your, you know, social security number out. But there's really not a lot you can do. It happens. It happens to all of us.
Right.
And it's not, you know, it's not preventable. Really, you have to, you know, clean it up after it's done, unfortunately.
Right.
And like I said, some of the big banks, like you said, you got a phone call from somebody that said, hey, they're using your credit, or there's some weird stuff going on.
Right.
You know, they're trying to prevent it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But it's tough to do.
Yeah, and so I mentioned earlier, you're an attorney. You do a lot of this stuff. And you've got a website?
www.myfaircreditsite.com.
Myfaircreditsite.com. And I know that you're like me in that if people have got questions, they've got thoughts, they've got concerns, they can call you and talk to you, right?
Anytime, free consultation. And, you know, the other thing is you can connect with me through my website and we can chat.
Okay.
We can type.
Yeah.
And, you know, I like helping people. I feel my expertise in credit and debt can help a lot of consumers. Just got to be smart. And
a lot of times, though, being intelligent knows who to ask.
That's right. It is. You gotta find the right person.
And I have people call my office all the time. They say, Steve, I've got a problem. I know it's not a lemon law problem, but it's something else. And they name something else.
Sure.
And it could be they're in another state, or it could be something wacky. You know, my husband was killed in a railroad accident.
Right.
You know, I'm like, oh, railroad law? I mean, there's got to be, you know. But there's attorneys that specialize in everything.
Sure.
And so they have to battle somebody finding the right person. But the key is they can look up your website. They can contact you, call you, email, whatever. And whether you can help them or not, you can certainly give them some good advice.
Sure. And just so, you know, everybody's clear, I'm only licensed to practice law in Michigan. Different states have different laws.
Right.
You can always find, you can Google somebody, you know, FDCPA lawyer, identity theft lawyer in your area, put your city next to it, and you'll pop up a bunch of lawyers or other professionals that can help you. But
I always tell people, if you're looking for a lemon law lawyer in Michigan, I do that. So does Adam. But if you're in another state, I go, well, type in Ohio lemon law lawyer, you know, and they'll find someone like me.
Yes.
And people go, well, Steve, but you talk to people. What about somebody else? I go, no, they'll talk to you too. And they go, how do you know that? I go, just trust me. They will.
Yeah.
You know,
most lawyers want to talk to you.
Yeah.
Especially in the consumer protection area, defective products.
And if there's
credit
a
reporting,
yeah, if
like
there's
that,
a law that you can use to help these people, it's often going to be a federal statute that has a fee shifting
component
where you can get your attorney fees paid by the bad guys if you can catch them, and you can usually figure that out in advance if it's worth pursuing.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, there's fee shifting where consumers don't have to pay attorney fees, and that's where we come in and take over.
Right, there you go. So once again, Adam Alexander, the first in studio guest, but this is a second appearance. Thank you very much.
Law. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And oh, for the use of the word derogated and the word
thefted,
you get to hold that, but you can't have it.
Okay.
There's a long story behind that. So, okay. Questions, comments from below. This is Steve Gutter. Bye-bye.